Biden administration officials recently replaced the words woman and mother in favor of the more gender-neutral birthing persons. Critics of the move are gathering this June 24th and 25th for the Summit for Survivors. Organizers say the summit will empower pro-family attendees with persuasive, carefully reasoned arguments, stories from the survivors, and the science from the experts. You can find more information at summitforsurvivors.org.
In this episode of the Ruth Institute podcast, we tune in to Father Rob Jack's radio show, Driving Home the Faith. Dr. Morse and Father Jack discuss the upcoming Summit for Survivors and where things stand regarding numbers and registration. Final deadline to register is this Sunday evening, June 19. Dr. Morse also explains that the hyper-sexualized content in academia did not spring up overnight and that already 25 years ago, identity politics could be seen in seed form. They also comment on Dr. Scott Yenor's recent exculpation and how the sexual revolutionaries tried to cancel him but failed. You can't cancel reality. Continue listening to hear the rest.
With us now is Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, and she heads the Ruth Institute, an interfaith nonprofit organization helping defend the family and repair the damage of the sexual revolution. Dr. Morse, how are things going with the Survivors Summit?
Well, we're doing great. We're pushing forward, and we are encountering people who can't come because this is because of the Sacred Heart. You know, there are several parishes that are having, you know, special masses that night and things like that. So it's like, oh my goodness, we didn't think of that when we selected the date. So there you go. We avoided Ember Days, for example. You know, we avoided other kinds of big holidays and stuff like that because if you have a conference on Ember Days and nobody's supposed to be eating anything, you know, that's kind of not very festive. So, but yeah, things are going great, honestly, Father.
How are your numbers so far with that?
Well, we've got about 150 coming to the main dinner, and we've got 75 coming for the whole big party, the more instructional part, right?
Right.
And then we've got a lot of low-hanging fruit in terms of parishes and individuals who said, oh, yeah, we're going to buy a table. Yeah, we're going to buy a table. We're going to be there. But next Friday is going to be the deadline, so people need to get on with it, you know, if they're really going to do it. But they will. You know how people are. We're way ahead of where we've ever been before in terms of attendance this far out, you know.
Well, Doctor, I think people are seeing, they definitely are seeing the need. All you have to do is turn on the news, and we can see that you can either give up or you can go on, you know, and we got to go on. We don't have a choice.
Yeah. Well, you know, people do have a choice, and I just want to say, if you're the kind of person who likes to sit around and complain, don't come. I don't have time. Just forget it. I just don't want to deal with it. You know, we had enough to deal with without that. But that's not going to happen. The people who come are people who want to get something done, or mostly people who are already active. You know, we have several seminarians coming from several different dioceses. We have high school teachers, a couple of high school teachers coming. We've got people who work in crisis pregnancy centers coming. And then we've got people who are not as well established in their jobs or careers or what have you, but who are very active in pro-life activities, you know, who, I go to West Coast March for Life every year, Dr. Morse, you know, this kind of young, enthusiastic person.
Well, it'd be great if we could get some politicians there or some, the school board members. That would be a nice thing.
I'm glad you said that, because it occurs to me that elected officials may feel a little shy about showing their face around me because, you know, I'm kind of tainted good.
Doctor, you're so gentle and with how you speak to people. And I mean, you know, you're about as subtle as a hurricane.
Well, that's true. But, you know, I am an official hate. I am on the hate list. I'm an official hater. And so, you know, politicos are nervous about that kind of thing. You know, what you went to that dinner, that woman dinner. But here's the thing. They should definitely send their staff members, because most of your elected officials do not have one stinking clue what to say or what to do when somebody shows up with a bill to subsidize to ban therapy. For example, you know, to ban any therapy other than gender-affirming therapy that just puts people on the conveyor belt attempting to change their gender. Your typical state legislator, they may be pro-life, they may be very well-meaning, but they have no clue what to say or do when they're confronted with that type of stuff. Because we had that. we had this in Baton Rouge just this last session. You know, this type of bill came down and people kind of stood there flat-footed and tongue-tied and not knowing what to say. Well, if you come hang around with us, you will learn what to say and you will get the confidence to say what needs to be said. And if you don't want to be seen or hanging around me, send your staff people. I'm not shy. You know, I understand. I understand that I'm a liability.
Dr. Morse, you're a wallflower. You just sit there and just radiate goodness and holiness, you know. Until you open your mouth, that is. You know, that's it.
You never know where I stand. You know, that's the thing with me.
That's true. Well, you know, speaking of that, you know, both you and I have been involved in academia for a long time, and I have a niece right now that's working on a PhD at Emory in classical languages and Roman and Greek history, and she's been telling me the courses she's listening to. I'm sitting there thinking, these are gender studies in the Roman Empire. I thought, please, come on, folks.
Yeah.
I mean, this is insane, this thing. Sexual habits in the Roman Empire or between the Greeks and the Romans. I said, what has this got to do with getting a classic degree? And then she just kind of rolls her eyes and says, I got to take this stuff. And I said,
This is the political correctness and, I don't know, hyper interest in things all matter sexual. This didn't spring up out of nowhere overnight. Okay. This has been around for a long time. So I haven't been in the classroom in 20 years or more. Right, so things have changed since I was teaching at George Mason. But even then, you could tell that there were these obsession with sexual matters, you know, as part of many of the humanities classes, and identity politics. It was already there 20 years ago, 25 years ago.
And, you know, the other side of it, Doctor, is not only the students as a teacher, and I felt this teaching in the seminary. You're walking a minefield because they always rate you academically based on your course evaluations by students, and if you're fair to the students, you demand things of the students, and you don't give them an extra break when they want one because you gave them three other ones, or you hand back a paper to be rewritten because of that. And then it comes for the evaluations, and then they hammer you and call you everything but, you know, whatever. And then you got to answer for yourself. And I see today the media release you sent out was that happened with the Institute Scholar of the Year, Dr. Kevin Yenor.
Yes, Dr. Scott Yenor is going to be our Scholar of the Year. And I picked him a long time ago because I love his work on political science, political theory, and the family. This is a guy, I may have told you about him before, Father. He's written a couple of books basically asking the question, what does modern philosophy have to say about family? Do they have anything sensible to say about marriage and family? And the short answer is no. They don't have anything sensible to say. And the only guy who does is this guy called Carol Wojtyla.
Yes.
John
Paul II, I believe, yes.
Yeah.
Well, Max Scheller helped a little bit, but, you know, in terms of most of the modern philosophers, they were too busy navel-gazing.
Well, he went through like, you know, Hobbes and Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau and all these people. And it's like, you know, it's no wonder we can't figure out what's going on, you know, when they're ignoring all of the central questions and the central issues for which the family is important. You know, if you start off assuming everybody is independent and everybody's autonomous, well, there's no need for love. There's no need for mothers and fathers, right? And the whole thing is very distorted. So I've loved Scott Yenor's work for a long time and, you know, had in mind I was going to honor him this year. And then come to find out that he was I don't want to call him a victim because he would bristle at being called a victim. But he was attacked by basically a trumped-up Twitter mob.
Was this on Twitter or were these I thought these were course evaluations, so this was actually a Twitter attack. Okay.
No, it wasn't course evaluations. I don't know the details. What it was is he gave a speech and somebody caught wind of the speech, and then there was a whole series of social media attacks against him. And so, you know, I may be speaking metaphorically to call it a Twitter mob, but basically it was an online mob, and they were making discrimination complaints, civil rights violations complaints. So it was not course evaluations. He had good course evaluations. He had kept meticulous records of who he graded, how he graded, you know, all this type of stuff. So there was, when they came after him and said, oh, it, because you said mean things about feminism, it must be that you are grading women unfairly. You know? And he wouldn't, you know, hauled out his stuff and said, here are the records. Yeah, no.
I did so that myself. I had tapes of all my lectures just so I could say, you got to do that because they'll say, you said this, really? Click. This is what I said, remember? I didn't know you were taping it. Yes, you did, because I gave you CDs in my class, you know?
I started making a practice of taping recording everything I said to some years ago, not just because of that, you know, that people might say, claim I said something that I didn't in fact say, but also because I kept winning debates, and then the tape of the event that I was promised would somehow disappear.
Oh, yeah.
And they could never find the tape, you know, where I obliterated my opponent. So I started recording myself.
I have here a copy inside the Title IX Tribunal, which Dr. Yenor wrote regarding this, and it does sound like a kangaroo court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like what they used to call the Star Chamber.
There you go.
Where you don't know your accuser, you don't know what they said, you don't have the chance to confront your accuser. That is all. I think the most shocking thing about this whole thing, and what I really want people to know, is that that's standard operating procedure for a lot of different types of cases on college campuses. So. Not just civil rights violations, but also sometimes if a young man's been accused of sexual harassment or something like that, the procedural norms that would be standard for any other type of case just go out the window. So that's a very serious matter, I think, you know, that we have chunks of our, it's not exactly the legal system, right, because it's not civil. It's not.
But there is a thing called due process. There's a due process.
But it's administrative law, I guess is what it's called, Father.
Yeah,
it's
that's true.
Yeah, it's not civil. It's not criminal. And different rules apply. But you can have your life ruined by one of those courts just as easily as by a civil court or a criminal court. You know?
Well, I mean, he points this out in his article. He says he wasn't ever declared innocent. He declared it wasn't proven. Well, okay.
Right.
So in other words, it's there, but he was good at hiding it. You know, not that we declare him innocent, but we can't prove what he did. It's a very different nuance.
Yes, and more than that, as he said, and this guy Ilya Shapiro, who resigned from Georgetown, this is another story that's floating around. What they'll do is, okay, you were proven innocent on this one, but some other thing may come up, and now we have a pattern of civil rights violations and insensitivity and so on and so forth. See, and so that's what Ilya Shapiro, I guess he's not a doctor, Ilya Shapiro decided that it made no sense for him to continue a job at Georgetown Law School when they quote-unquote exonerated him but didn't exonerate him. You know, they were waiting. It's like they're lying in wait for him to make a misstep. And he said, I'm not working under these conditions. What are you, crazy? You know, in effect is what he said. And you can see why. But this type of stuff is more common than you might think. And I just think your listeners and ordinary folk need to know that these kind of courts are, you know, nestled away in various parts of society, you could say, you know. And they're not well supervised, and they don't have anything like what a normal person would consider due process.
Well, and not only that, it's just the fact that as you said, there's no freedom of speech here. And, you know, I think, you know, when you figure parents are spending $30,000 or $40,000 a year to send their children to college, it's $160,000. And you figure that you want your children to come out to have a productive life, to be educated, to have a degree of culture, but none of that is there anymore.
Right, right. And you know, the same people who are saying to us, trust the science, trust the experts, these are also the people who control all of the credentialing organizations that credential experts and scientists. And so you have to run the gauntlet of their ideological litmus tests before you can have the gold star on your forehead that says, expert, listen to me, you know. And in the meantime, the respect for evidence and due process and freedom of speech and freedom of inquiry and ideas confronting one another so that the best idea wins, you know, that's all shot. You know, that's all. And it's really gone. And the university, it's easier for you and I to have a debate here on the radio than it is for the typical university. You know, it's very hard to have an honest to goodness debate.
Well, we've seen that if there's certain minority groups of students, especially of the more conservative bent, want to have a speaker come in, everybody goes just, you know, completely berserk.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Pickets and riots and goes on, and finally the person has to, or the person is simply asked not to come. And again,
yeah.
The whole point of education is that education, the pursuit of the truth, and that's gone. That has simply left the building.
It's tragic, but that's, I think it's important to understand that this is where we are. This is how things are, and you can wring your hands over it. But you have to face it. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. You're not going to get anywhere by hiding from it. And so what do we do about it? Well, we organize ourselves in such a way that where it's possible for alternative ideas to be heard. You know, you can have your own YouTube channel. You can have your own conferences like we're having. You can have your own radio station. And never, ever silence yourself. Do not silence yourself. Don't censor yourself, right? That make them shut you up. Make them look bad. You know what I mean?
Oh, and I know. I've been there. Believe.
Yeah, and that's what I like about Yenor. You know, he didn't back down, and he didn't go away quietly, and he didn't play nicely. He just said, you know, okay, here are the facts, and let's deal with it. You know.
But Dr. Morse, we need to stop. We're out of time. But thank you for being with us today. And if people want to find out more about your conference and get your newsletters and see your Dr. J show, where can we send them?
Please come to ruthinstitute.org, and you can look for the summit page. There's a huge banner on our homepage, and you can get all the information about the summit and join us virtually if you can't join us in person.
Well, thank you very much.
The traditional family is under attack. Are you tired of standing there flat-footed and tongue-tied when your Christian beliefs are under attack? Join me, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana, at the Ruth Institute Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution. Join hundreds of other people to get compelling stories, persuasive arguments, and the science to back it all up. Defend your values without fear or apology. Our website is summitforsurvivors.org.